2020, when these results were not yet published. This was published a few months later, which is, you know, what do you think this is? Most of you intuitively would say, this looks like a thermodynamic cycle. This is actually the cycle of activation, the pharmacological cycle of activation of a GPCR that can activate spontaneously or with a ligand. So if we map this pharmacological cycle onto the structures of the receptor, here we have the ligand or we have the basal activity, but we can say, well, we can compare this with a version of the ligand that does not activate the receptor and that blocks it. And then we can just solve the FEP solvable legs. And this was the basis of this pharmacological efficacy that we saw yesterday, both by Francesca and by the Schrodinger presentation. So here we tested this in a number of ligands that were agonists or some chemical modifications made them an antagonist. And here we're talking about antagonists. This is like, you know, it just blocks the receptor. It doesn't have necessarily selectivity for the inactive conformation. That would be an inverse agonist. But what we want to see is that the agonist has exaggerated affinity or preferential affinity for the active form of the receptor. So we saw this for this series of ligands, but also for different chemical series of ligands. This is one that we have designed previously, not based on FEP simulation. So this was like a retrospective confirmation that these chemical modifications were actually doing selective conformational preference for the active form and making these ligands agonists. And for a third chemotype of partial agonists, we saw the same thing. So we also worked on the mutations because some mutations stabilize the conformation of the receptor in the active or the inactive. They make it constitutively active or inactive. So it's the same cycle, but instead of doing ligand FEP, you do residue FEP. So we saw that we could see this effect, and moreover, we could see the combination of how a ligand can shift the effect of a mutation, or how the mutation, in this case, can shift the effect of a ligand, and a given mutation can make that the ligand is no longer so agonist and is more like a partial agonist or not, or an antagonist. So, all in all, I think that, I don't know why this is yellow, I forgot it, but I think that we can say that we can also predict the pharmacological profiling of ligands with FEP simulations, as we also saw that yesterday others like picked up and continue doing. And I'm very, very happy to see that this is like leading somewhere, because we cannot activate the receptors. These are milliseconds tail. So thermodynamic cycles for this type of problem are fantastic. Just the last slide showing that, as I said, I mean, as a spin-off company, we have a pipeline of applying and using FEP simulations in the context of a longer thing, especially on GPCRs, and we have we have a collaboration here to do the chemoinformatics, and last but not least, to mention here all the people that really did the hard work in getting the results that I'm showing you. So Willem here and Tana that I saw the computational results, and Ruben, the chemist, and also the lead chemist, Eddie Sotelo, and all the people doing experiments here, Laura and Mabel and Andreas. And thank you. I'm sorry for being a bit late. And if you have any question, I'm very happy to answer. Yeah, so in this case, the homology model of the A2B receptor was built on basis of homology with the A2A receptor. The homology, the sequence ID is around 60% of these two receptors. The binding pocket is the orthosteric binding pocket, so there's no question about it. We know where the ligands will bind, and actually, it was, if we need it, it was confirmed by the cryo-EM structure. These ligands are not allosteric ligands. We are actually working on that now. We have a project where we want to find allosteric sites on the A2A receptor with fragments. That's another approach, and that's another question, another challenge. We did not repeat the calculations with an AlphaFold model, simply because we have a model that has been validated so much, and it has been like equilibrated around these structures that we are working with, that it has been optimized. So I don't think that it will improve the question, especially if you use the default alpha fold where it doesn't really distinguish between active and inactive. So we can have some kind of like in between, as I saw in the poster of your colleague. I don't know where she's sitting, but yeah, here, sorry. Yeah. So yeah, I mean, we've been discussing about that. So yeah. So in this case, it wouldn't make an advantage.
Okay, if there is no more question, let's thank the speaker.
Thank you.